Go ahead. Recording is running.
Okay. Thank you and welcome at the 19th Workplace NIA User Group Netherlands Tuesday webinar. Today we have a special session from Kenneth van Surksem, our own Kenneth van Surksem. He's one of our board members of the User Group, and he will have a demos heavy session about Azure AD conditional access. But first, let's thank our sponsors for allowing us to organize user group events. Hopefully we will be back on premise later this year when the vaccine has shipped to everyone and everybody was able to get the vaccine. But until then, we are virtual. But nevertheless, thank you for our sponsors. Please follow us on Twitter, Meetup, of course, Facebook, YouTube, and LinkedIn. And if you have an ID, please reach out to us for instance, the next session or whatsoever. The upcoming events, next week we will have another Ask Us Anything, live Ask Us Anything with Samantha Close-Kilkins about identity governance and passwordless. In 2 weeks from now, we have our new webinar again with Thomas Maurer. 2 weeks after that with Patrick van der Born. And we have planned many more sessions for the rest of the first half of the year. If you want to have a session at one of our webinars, feel free to reach out because we are all friends. We are always among friends. So don't hesitate to reach out if you have an ID for a session or something interesting to tell us. Learning by sharing, that's our motto. So, but now, Kenneth, the floor is yours. If you have questions, please use the chat or unmute and we will handle this.
Great, thanks Peter for the announcement. Let me switch to my slide deck. So one moment. Go. So, well, welcome everyone. Thank you for taking the time to listen to my talk about Azure AD conditional access. This is a presentation I have given before in other user groups, but I'm actually updating it on a monthly basis. Making sure that the latest tips and tricks are mentioned. And of course, I want to share my mistakes with you, so you don't have to make them. A little bit about myself, Kenneth van Surksem. I'm co-founder and organizer at the Workplace NIA User Group Netherlands, the meetup where you guys are actually part of at the moment. I blog at my blog www.vansurksem.com, and yeah, here are the details. We will share the slides, and if you have any follow-up questions after the meeting, the details are in there, and you can reach me with further questions if you might have them. So. For today, what we are going to talk about is actually, of course, we will start with what conditional access is. I'm going to tell a little bit about how it works. There are some things that you need to know there. What you have to take into account when designing a conditional access policy or multiple conditional access policies. I will go into more detail about implementing conditional access and actually sharing with you also my default set of conditional access policies. They are available for everyone to download, and I will give you some context about how I created those policies and what actually the scenarios are which are supported there. And I was about to say, if time permits, but we might have some time left because I determine my own time in this case. We will do a little bit more detail in how to properly troubleshoot conditional access as well. So, well, the slide says it all. Identity is the new perimeter, and what we mean with that is that traditionally, actually, companies hosted all their data and applications within their own building, their own data center, and actually that was all protected by what we know nowadays as a firewall. But there was a certain point in time that companies actually started moving resources to the public cloud. And I think for most of my customers, that first step was made for those companies by actually making use of Exchange Online and migrating their on-premises Exchange infrastructure to the cloud variant hosted by Microsoft. And because of that, actually having a firewall to protect your on-premises environment is still necessary, but you need to figure out something else to actually protect your resources and your company data, which is hosted in the public cloud. And actually the public cloud already tells the challenge we have here, because one of the properties of a public cloud is the fact that it's available everywhere. So there is no firewall around your public cloud, and therefore we actually need to protect the identity of the user. Yeah, so in this case, when it comes to what we are talking about today, we need to protect the identity which is stored in Azure Active Directory. So that is actually the challenge that we have, and where actually conditional access can play an important role. So when we look at the official definition coming from Microsoft, they have a whole definition about what conditional access is, and I'm not going to read it out loud, but what's important from actually the documentation is two things. That's actually that conditional access policies are enforced after the first factor authentication has been completed. That means that with conditional access, you cannot circumvent, for example, people trying to log in with use ID and password and just trying until they have the correct password. So those kind of attacks cannot be stopped with conditional access. What we can stop is actually all that can happen after the first initial logon. So that's something important to remember. And therefore, conditional access is not intended to prevent denial of service attacks or other things. Microsoft has services in place, but they are part of the Microsoft offering, so they can detect denial of service and deny access or do some other things, but it's not something that conditional access is meant for. So what is conditional access in my words? It's actually putting conditions in place to access the company data and applications, and actually therefore protecting the identity and the device. So that's actually what we are doing. And you can actually compare it to using flowcharts to determine whether access is granted or being denied. Or we even have a flavor where access is granted, but we make sure that certain restrictions are in place. For example, you cannot download any files or print any attachments in an email when accessing. It can be compared with a network firewall, but then for your identity, yes, something I explained already before. The resources being accessed must use Azure Active Directory as their authentication provider. So that makes sense, for example, if you are using Exchange Online, SharePoint Online, etc. Hence, I even had customers which I asked, are you using Azure Active Directory? They actually told me, no, we are not. But then I said, well, but you are using Exchange Online, and they didn't even know that they were using Azure Active Directory, because Azure Active Directory is like a platform which is a prerequisite to actually start using Exchange Online, for example. So an important one is that if even though you can use conditional access, it doesn't mean that you are licensed. And what I mean with that actually is that, for example, if you have an Azure AD tenant and you would buy one license of Azure AD Premium P1, your whole Azure Active Directory tenant is providing the functionalities which belong to that license. And that means that, that if you, for example, have 50 users, you could actually put functionality in place for those 50 users. But keep in mind that Microsoft officially states that if you benefit from the service, that you must be licensed for it as well. So therefore, licensing is quite important. And keep in mind that even though you have functionality available, that doesn't mean that you are also able or that you are legally able to use it. When using ADFS, it can become quite complex. I think that most companies which I visit and which still have ADFS actually created their ADFS setup and their federation with Azure Active Directory at a time that there were no good alternatives available. Nowadays, with password hash sync, pass-through authentication, and actually the agents which are there, I think that they have become the better alternative and they are much easier to manage. As you can see, the ask yourself whether you still need ADFS as a link. So if you want to know a little bit more about that, because that's another topic, please visit the link and I will explain everything that you need to determine in order if you still need ADFS. And you might start a project to do a phasing out of that. What conditional access also does, if you enable it, it adds points to your secure score. And personally, I think that the secure score is a good way to measure if you're making the right steps. So it can help you to determine what the priorities are and in what kind of steps you can take to make your environment better and better. And you visited us at the session we had last year with hosted by Sami, where Sami said, well, nowadays it's not a matter of being fully secure, but making sure that your environment is more secure than the environment of your neighbor at the moment. And that's something that we can do by actually following up on the points which secure score has. So what are the prerequisites before implementing Azure Active Directory? Well, that basically has something to do with the box you see in my slide, where actually connecting to Office 365 services is being done by only using a username and password. And we actually call that legacy authentication nowadays. And legacy authentication is bad. Why? Because with legacy authentication, we can actually bypass conditional access or other measures like MFA, etc. So legacy authentication must be disabled. Because it's also vulnerable to brute force password spray attacks. And up until, I think, 2 weeks ago, Microsoft was also planning to disable legacy authentication, also known as basic authentication, for Exchange Online in the second half of this year. But because of the whole pandemic and the whole COVID-19 situation, they actually postponed that decision. And they announced that they will make a new announcement up till 12 months before they are going to turn it off. So that won't be before February or March next year. Even though Microsoft said, well, we are not going to disable it, they are going to disable legacy authentication protocols if you are not using it within your tenant. So they will measure if it's in use, and if it's not in use, they will disable it for you. My personal recommendation for you is if you were already busy with phasing out legacy authentication, please continue with that. And if you haven't taken any steps yet, I strongly advise you to have a look at phasing out legacy authentication. And also for that, I wrote an extensive blog article, which you can read and giving you some details on what steps you need to take. Another prerequisite is actually that you need Azure AD Premium P1 or P2 license. If you don't have those licenses, you cannot implement Azure AD Conditional Access, but you can turn on the security defaults. And with turning on the security defaults, you actually implement a standard set of conditional access policy, where actually one of the settings that you implement is actually the blocking of legacy authentication. So again, and I believe if I'm correct, Microsoft now turns off security defaults are turned on by default on newly created tenants as well. So, if you want to do something with devices and giving them access based on compliance, you of course need Microsoft Endpoint Manager. You need an endpoint management solution to measure compliance, and based on that, either give or deny access to the environment. More on that later as well. And you might need to rethink your re-authentication settings. So for example, your MFA global settings, a lot of customers which I visit have different settings for different users when it comes to MFA settings. When you want to enforce MFA using conditional access, you actually disable MFA on a global level. And then actually use conditional access to determine in what situation you want to ask for multi-factor authentication. Also make sure that you actually know what Keep Me Signed In does and how you can use that for either your advantage or not. And there's another setting in MFA actually giving you the option to actually remember your MFA request on trusted devices. And also make sure that you either disable that setting or make sure that it actually aligns with the token lifetime which the devices get from Azure AD. Another important one is actually make sure that you have defined two break class accounts. And those break class accounts later on in our conditional access policies will actually be excluded from each conditional access policy. Microsoft has an old article on what to do with those two break class accounts. They actually recommend two and actually protecting them in a different way as well by using, for example, two multi-factor authentication providers, or protect one with a security key and the one other one with MFA. And that actually brings me to one of the reasons I decided to actually do a deep dive in conditional access myself, because it was around 2016 and I was playing with conditional access and I actually managed to lock myself out. And I had to create a support call with Microsoft in order to have that policy which I created disabled, allowing me to access my environment again. And that actually for me was the trigger. Hey, this is something which is interesting. I need to know more about. So therefore, So don't forget your break class accounts and make sure that you have them available. And break class accounts also means that it's not accounts that you use on a regular basis. Those are accounts which you only use if you really need them. Coming back to the topic of legacy authentication, I prepared a small demo and how you can easily see whether legacy authentication is still in use within your own tenant. If you have the Azure AD console open, you can also click together with me. And if you see that you still have legacy authentication in use, you might have some work to do. So let's see if we can switch. Let me see, we can switch, there we go. So this is actually the one of my test tenants. And as you can see, I started the Azure AD sign-in logging. You might be familiar with that. I don't have many sign-ins, as I said, because it's one of my test tenants. And let's hope that my requests are not throttled at the moment, something I had last week. But what you can actually do is filter on the client applications. Ah, there's the throttling again. Sorry for that. But what you can do is you can actually create a filter and pick client app as the field. And if you actually make a selection, you actually see that Microsoft has already categorized all the client apps in use. So you either have the modern authentication clients, which are either the browser, Edge, Chrome, etc. Or you have legacy authentication clients. So this is actually quite a pain. You need to select them all individually. They rather have an option to have select all, but that's not the case. And actually, if you do that, and the demo gods are a little bit with me, you will actually see all the sign-ins using legacy authentication within your environment. Well, for demo purposes, this is only one. But here, as you can see, we have one sign-in. It's an interactive sign-in, I mean, it's done by an application. And what you can see here is that, for example, the client app or the protocol being used is POP3, which is actually one of the protocols which supports both legacy and modern authentication. So if you see this happening, you might want to do something, because as far as I know, not many mail clients already support POP3 with modern authentication. And this can actually help you to determine whether work needs to be done. If you forward your sign-in logging to a Log Analytics workspace, you can actually make use of the workbooks functionality. I haven't configured that in my test tenant. I might be able to show you that in my other tenant. But actually, the workbooks actually provide like a dashboard on the Log Analytics data, giving you more insights in whether legacy authentication is being used. And there's actually a workbook included already, giving you details about legacy authentication. So you don't have to create anything there. It's available for you to use. And that's basically it. So it's actually a quick way to determine whether legacy authentication is still in use. And again, we are able to disable legacy authentication using a conditional access policy. But I can tell you from experience that if you start doing that now, and while you see that users are still using it, you can, of course, expect some more phone calls to your service desk, because applications will simply stop working. So you need to implement this in a project form and make sure that users are informed and know what to do before you turn off legacy authentication. So to continue with my presentation. How does conditional access work? Well, that actually starts with all kinds of signals. And those signals are, of course, which signals are available depends on the scenario. We have devices, the user itself, the location of the user. We actually have the application in use and whether that user has a risk, as identified by Azure AD Identity Protection, where actually Adnan had a session about a couple of weeks ago. So. Have a look at our YouTube channel if you want to know more about that. And actually, based on those signals, we can actually model whether we allow access, whether we block access, or that we actually give access but require something else, like, for example, MFA. And we can then give access to either the applications or the data being hosted in our SharePoint environment, our Teams environment, OneDrive, etc. So Microsoft explains it as follows. They say, well, you in a conditional access policy, you actually determine first when this happens, the scenario, and then actually what you actually allow. And when this happens, it's being translated to what we call conditions. And then do this is translated into access controls. And those combined can be seen as a conditional access policy. So, well, you can have one or multiple conditional access policies in your environment, and more on that later as well. So, when figuring out how conditional access works, I actually decided to write down in my own words how it works, which actually led to the following formula. And again, I'm not going to repeat what's on the screen, but I hope this gives you an idea that actually this simple concept in practical is a lot more complex. And there are many do's and don'ts and when a conditional access does work and doesn't work. And actually I learned myself by doing it wrong multiple times. And actually have taken those lessons learned in my basic set of conditional access policies. What I did is actually I translated this formula into an A4 size cheat sheet, as I call it, which is available for download. And I always have it with me when I troubleshoot conditional access. So that I actually use this flowchart when something goes wrong. So I know it's a little bit small on the screen, but I will provide you with the links where you can actually download this one for yourself. You can either print it out or have it on the second screen while you are working with conditional access. And it has recently been updated, so it's fully up to date with the latest functionality within conditional access. So some important rules here is that conditional access policies are enforced in two phases. So they are enforced in parallel, which is important to know as well. And first of all policies are evaluated and access controls that aren't satisfied are collected. And in the second prompt, you are prompted to satisfy the requirement you haven't met. So for example, in the second phase, it might be that you get a request for MFA on your authenticator app. If there's only one policy blocking access, you will be denied access. So it doesn't matter if there are 10 other policies which grant you access. Deny access is always wins, and therefore you should also be very careful with blocking access. As I said, make sure that for each policy that blocks access that you have your break class accounts excluded, have them excluded on each conditional access policy to be certain. Because once you are blocked and you have no other means to actually access the environment, you have an issue. If none of the policies block you, you need to satisfy other policy controls in the following order, if they are specified. So multi-factor authentication comes first. It might be that you are being checked for either an approved client app or an app which has an app protection policy applied. There are some things there which you need to take into account when it comes to that. It might be that you either need to come from what we call a managed device, which is a device which is either Azure AD hybrid joined, which means Active Directory joined, domain joined, but registered in Azure Active Directory, or the device should be compliant. And the only way to measure compliance is, of course, to use Microsoft Endpoint Manager. So you should use Microsoft Endpoint Manager. It might be that in certain circumstances, users need to accept terms of use first, like a written policy telling you all the things, how you can access the environment and what the requirements are. And you might use custom controls. And custom controls might be, for example, an add-in which you have with a third-party supplier of MFA, to give you an example. Another thing we need to realize ourselves is that if you enable a conditional access policy, that they are not always effective immediately. So for example, some policies, if you enable a policy, they will become effective, for example, if a token refresh takes place for the user, which isn't always immediately. So therefore, also when you are testing with conditional access policies and you do a lot of testing, make sure that you reserve a certain time frame that you know, within the time frame, the policy must have been effectively. Another thing you can do on the back end is to use the Azure AD signing logging to determine whether the policy was applicable for a certain action that you are testing. Unfortunately, we don't have an option on the client itself, like a GP update /force, to make sure that all the policies are effective immediately either. That will change. I think that with continuous access evaluation, which is currently in preview, we will get quicker results. That means that with conditional access evaluation, we can have quicker checks in case certain signals change. I did some early testing with that, and that's really hopeful. Continuous access evaluation will help, for example, with the scenario where you are working within the office and have a trusted IP address, for example. You actually you close your laptop and you go to nearby Starbucks and connect to a public Wi-Fi network. With continuous access evaluation, you will actually that will be detected immediately, and you will, for example, be asked to provide MFA if you modeled that in your conditional access policy. So when designing a conditional access policy, you have to do some information gathering, of course. I wrote down some of them. I will not go into detail in for each of them, but make sure that you know what's currently in place. If you have a greenfield scenario, so a customer actually spinning up a new Azure AD environment with all the services, you're actually lucky. But in my work, I never meet customers who do a greenfield scenario. I actually had one, to be honest. So that actually means that if you are start implementing conditional access, you are talking about a migration and not about a greenfield implementation. Make sure that you know whether the customer currently uses Intune, Microsoft Endpoint Manager, what kind of scenarios they use. Are they using MDM only? Are they using mobile application management? Is every user treated equally within the company? It might be that, for example, you have some administrative personnel which has a lower risk than persons with high privilege rights, and you might need to model that in your conditional access policies as well. Licensing is very important, and in my opinion, you need E5 functionality for at least your administrators. So people administering or holding administrative roles to your Azure Active Directory. I'm also an advocate for the fact that if you give your users admin rights on their workplace, that you need E5 functionality as well. And especially having enterprise or endpoint detection and response tooling in place to actually detect whether there are breaches, etc. How licenses are being assigned, I still see many companies actually assigning licenses directly to users, where actually the whole licensing is actually a mess. So make sure that you use Azure AD groups there and use group-based licensing. Whether service accounts are being used, service accounts in the traditional way. So those are accounts coming from Active Directory, where actually an on-premises application is using a service account to access, for example, data hosted on SharePoint, etc. make sure that you know what is going on there. See if you can migrate those accounts either to service principles or use managed identities if possible. And if not, and you really need to use those service accounts, make sure that you, for example, create a conditional access policy that those accounts can only log in from trusted IPs and not from the whole world. That will actually make a big difference. Modern authentication, whether that's already enabled, whether password hashes are being synced to Azure Active Directory, and many more. Microsoft provides some documentation which can actually help you, but I have something available as well, which I will share later with you as well. But actually, the Microsoft documentation is quite good as a starting point. Once you actually created the inventory of the environment of the customer, I think it's important to define some scenarios and actually write them down in conditional access policies. So as you can see, I've defined five scenarios as an example, but below in italic, I actually wrote them out in what I call how a conditional access policy should be modeled. The reason why we are doing it like this is because if we have a scenario, we can easily test it once the conditional access policies have been implemented. And again, these are pure illustrational. Some make sense, but they don't have to make sense for your environment. So when implementing conditional access at my customers, I always have goals. And my goals are always to use conditional access to implement the company data, the company applications which use single sign-on because they use Azure AD as their identity provider, and I want to protect the identity of the users. So all my conditional access policies actually have that goal, that common goal in mind. So when defining conditional access policies, I always start with the company data. So the company data, again, is data hosted on SharePoint, data in Teams, data within the mailbox of the user, or data stored in an application, a SaaS-based application, which the customer use. And based on that, I'm going to define scenarios. So the first scenario there is actually the scenario where mobile device management is being used to manage the devices which access that company data. And as you can see here, we actually use the fact that a device is compliant as a reason to give access to that data. The reason why compliancy for the device is so important because we can only use compliant or non-compliant in our conditional access policies. And that basically means that if a device is not compliant, it's not compliant. And not compliant devices is actually each device on the internet. So also the internet per se in the hotel while you are on holiday, or maybe somebody else his or her PC, that's all considered non-compliant. And therefore, you might need to model, or you need to model the scenario on what to do with those non-compliant devices. And in my case, I say, well, you cannot directly access the company data if you are not compliant, but I'm allowing you access to the company data using the browser in which I have restrictions available. So we can have app enforced restrictions in the browser, which actually gives us the possibility to provide access to, for example, to Outlook web access or SharePoint, etc. But we cannot download or print any files. So the company data stays within the browser and cannot leak from the browser. So users are not able to download it, etc. So, the second or the third scenario, to be honest, is a little bit more interesting, and that actually has to do with mobile devices. So if you look at the device owner and look at mobile devices, we see scenarios where actually people within a company are provided with a mobile device from the company, but they actually treat it as their personal device. And so they install all kinds of applications on it, and they rather not have the company managing the whole device. And I'm not really certain if this is a Dutch thing only, but I see that a lot within Dutch companies, that actually, even though the device is owned by the company, is being treated as personal. And therefore, actually, people don't accept the company to fully manage the mobile device. The alternative we have for those kinds of devices, or devices which are bought by the users themselves, is actually to implement mobile application management. And by implementing what we call app protection policies and app configuration policies if you need them, there's only one disadvantage of MDM and MUM, is that it can only, your device can only be managed by one MDM or MUM provider. So for example, if you have a device which is already managed by MUM by another company, you cannot manage the application on that device using MUM and Intune. And therefore it's actually, we have the scenario where if MUM is not possible, we can allow browser access on a mobile device. You might have tried it already, yeah? Go to portal.office.com on a mobile device, and it actually looks good nowadays. So that's because that whole portal is responsive and actually looks good on smaller devices as well. And you can actually even write an email in a good way, but you are not able to download files or print it from your mobile device, but it's workable. Yeah? I'm not saying you have full functionality, but if you have the capability of providing MUM functionality on the device, you of course need to use applications which support MUM, like Outlook, the SharePoint app, or the Office app, etc. But then you can actually give access to the company data. We can actually measure whether an approved application or an application with an app protection policy in place is being used, and actually use that to give access to the company data. So that's another scenario. And the last, which is an important one, is actually determine what we are going to do with all the guest users that we invite to either cooperate within a Teams environment, or with which we share company data. And what we see nowadays, and that's actually by design, that if you, for example, invite a guest user to a Teams environment, that guest user can use the Teams desktop client to actually participate in the Teams for which you invited him or her. And that means also that that user could download all the files in a SharePoint library and host it on their device. That device is not managed, and therefore you should really ask yourself if you want to allow that, if that data contains sensitive information. So you need to have something in place there. What we can do there is either say, well, okay, guest users can access the environment, but we only allow access using the web browser again and having the restrictions in place, or you can allow it. But keep in mind that you might need to think about protecting the actual data in that case. That means implementing Microsoft Information Protection and having encryption in place as well. So based on the scenarios I defined, yours can be different, but based on my experience, these are the scenarios that most companies actually have and want to support. There are some consequences, of course. So first of all, if you have users on mobile devices and they are still using built-in mail applications, like the Google Mail or the Apple Mail applications, they need to be migrated to Outlook. And one of the advantages of that is that Outlook is one of the applications actually supporting modern authentication as well. So you need to migrate to Outlook and all the other Office applications, because they are on the approved application list. Again, there's a Microsoft provides documentation on what's on the approved applications list. There are some third-party apps in there as well, but mainly the Microsoft applications are, of course, on the approved applications list. There are some caveats with when it comes to applications which support app protection policies, because, for example, Microsoft Teams is not one of them yet. If we are going to give guest users access to our environment, we must implement some kind of guest user governance. So you might already have seen that by default, each user can invite guest users. By default, each guest user can invite other guest users in your tenant to participate. By default, guest users are never cleaned up. So Microsoft recently implemented a functionality for which you need Azure Active Directory Premium P2 to have what we call access reviews on guest users within Teams environments. But even with that in place, guest users are not automatically removed from your Azure Active Directory. And therefore, you might want to implement some governance around that. For example, cleaning up guest users which haven't logged in for more than half a year within your Azure Active Directory. And there's no pain there, because if they haven't logged in for more than half a year, and it might be that they need access again, they just can re-request that access, they get a new invite, and then they can access the environment again. So make sure that you clean up those guest users. Because if a guest account is compromised, could be Gmail, Hotmail, etc., that compromised account and the people or the person having that credentials can actually access your company data as well and do stuff with that, even write in some documents. So make sure that you do something and that you have control over there. I see a lot of customers having actually more guest users at the moment than having internal users, which says something in my opinion. I already told that before, we must review the usage of non-personal accounts, service accounts, and what we want to do with that, because we want, for example, each account to have multi-factor authentication enabled, and we don't want exclusions, to be honest. So based on that, I created a set of conditional access policies. I made a nice picture of that, so I worked on my physio skills, and I will go into more detail later on. But as you can see, there are many policies in place, and I will give you some more detail later on what those policies do and how I set up my conditional access policies. So some things to remember when actually seeing the conditional access policy is that Microsoft recommends to create as less conditional access policies as possible. I deviate from that recommendation because I prefer granularity. And the reason for that is actually, there are multiple reasons, but I have seen, especially when migrating customers, that having options or temporarily exclusions available for you is actually really going to help you. So therefore, for each functionality which you saw in my flowchart, I actually have an exception possibility available as well. Well, where I can actually temporarily give users an exception for a specific use case, while still being able to migrate them to the model of conditional access policy. So each conditional access policy in my setup also has a specific exclude group, which is an Azure Active Directory group. And a member of that exclude group is always the break class accounts. If you have Azure AD Premium P2, you might want to use the access review functionality to regularly review the members of those exclusion groups. I follow the Microsoft best practices when it comes to naming standards. So Microsoft has a document on what those naming standards are, but I actually adopted it a little bit. So when it comes to to actually the naming, I actually have some conditional access prerequisites. I have user-based conditional access policies. I have device-based conditional access policies and conditional access policies based on location. So I added that to my naming. I also added a number so that I can distinct them. And actually that first number in the example CAD007 is actually the number which I use in my Azure AD group for the exclusion as well. And as you might see, I also version my conditional access policies. That means that once a conditional access policy is finished and in production, that I don't touch the conditional access policy anymore. I see a lot going wrong with actually administrators making modifications to the existing conditional access policies, having unwanted side effects. So make sure that if you do it using the versioning, you simply implement a version 1.1 of the new conditional access policy and make use of deployment groups, just like you do with your Windows updates, to actually make sure that you test that new conditional access policy on on that group first. So don't be stubborn there. Actually, make sure that you have like a release management process in place there as well. It can really help you. Besides that, be consistent in your naming. Make sure that within the conditional access policy, you can see in one view what the conditional access policy does. That's also important while troubleshooting. And it can also help you with troubleshooting when looking in the signing logging later on. So based on the conditional access policies which I described in this table, I will describe some of them. When it comes to the prerequisite policies, I actually have two. The first one is, of course, to block legacy authentication, which makes sense. I already told we need to block legacy authentication in order to make sure that actually we know for sure that conditional access policy is always in place. And the second one deserves some more context because I want to block Exchange Active Sync. I don't want Exchange Active Sync to be used anymore because that's being used by all those mail apps which I do not want to support because I want to work towards the usage of the Outlook app. But what I actually do is I use a grant policy, so I give access, but I require an approved application. And the difference compared to blocking access is actually that if you use a block in the second policy, the user simply won't get any email anymore. The access is blocked and the user will actually not notice, besides the fact that no email will arrive in the mailbox. And he or she will probably call the service desk and ask what's going on. If we use a require approved app and grant access, actually the user will get a notification that they will need to install the Outlook app and roll out their device using Outlook. So I personally think that's a more user-friendly approach. But from a conditional access perspective, actually giving grant access to block something is something which requires a little bit more explanation. Another example, and for this you actually need Azure AD Premium P2, is that you have the option to route sessions through Microsoft Cloud App Security. I already gave the example for example, users on non-compliant devices accessing the environment using the web browser and not being able to download or print. If you want to accomplish the same, for example, for a third-party SaaS application, you need to reverse proxy that application through Microsoft Cloud App Security. And you need to onboard that application. So if you have worked with cloud app security, you know what to do there. You need to install some certificates, etc. But based on that, you might actually say, well, for those applications on compliant devices, I am only going to monitor the usage of those applications, and you can actually see the usage of those applications back in Microsoft Cloud App Security, and you can have reporting, etc. But on non-compliant devices, I'm actually going to block downloads. And then you have similar functionality as you have with app-enforced restrictions within the Office platform. But you need Azure AD Premium P2 for every user benefiting from the service. And if you implement this for all users, each user must be licensed for the MCAS functionality in this case. If you have, again, this is again an Azure AD Premium P2 functionality. And this is actually implements the same policies which you have when you configure Azure AD Identity Protection. As Adnan already told a couple of weeks ago, within Azure AD Identity Protection, you can either say, well, if a user's signing risk is high, we require multi-factor authentication. And if a user risk is high, we require the user to change his or her password. And we can do that, for example, by implementing the self-service password reset functionality. I prefer to actually have these policies in conditional access as well and disable them in identity protection so that I have a one-stop where all my conditional access policies are. Make sure that if you have them enabled in both places, that you have the same settings applied. Because if not, yeah, you might have not such concrete results. This is a block policy which I implement as last at my customers, but that means that we really need to have our things in order, because what we are going to do with this policy is we are going to make sure that users who have access to the environment are properly licensed. That means that we make them member of an Azure Active Directory group, give the license to the group. And what we are actually going to do is actually say, well, for everyone who is not in those groups, we are going to deny access. So we are going to apply it to all users, but we are going to exclude the license group for that. In the exclude group, we are also going to, of course, include some of the accounts which need access to the environment while not needing the licenses. And those are, for example, your service accounts, if you still have them, but also your administrative accounts, of course. Be very careful when you implement this policy. Make sure that the break glass accounts are excluded and have it run in report only mode for at least a month. So that you make sure that if you enable it, that you know for sure that it's going to work. If you have this in place, life becomes simple afterwards, because you can never have situations where users have off functionality because they can access the environment but are not licensed. So licensing is really key here. And for me, that starts with actually implementing, make sure that you have Azure AD groups and use that to provide licenses to your users to start with. Another one, this one is important as well. We only grant access to devices if they are compliant. And that means some good examples are you have devices on which your users are local administrator. We see it more and more. One of the disadvantages is that they can disable BitLocker, they can disable their firewall, they can remove the antivirus software if they want to. Measure on those specific topics which you find important And it's okay that they removed the antivirus software, but you declare the device non-compliant and they cannot get access to the environment using their modern authentication or modern client apps, the way we call them. And they can simply get access again, but they have to become compliant in order to do so. So that can really simplify your deployment, but making sure that devices are compliant and keeping them compliant can be a challenge in some companies. It requires some effort, I can tell you from experience. Make also sure that if you do a rollout of Windows 10, that secure boot is enabled, that you have all the necessary settings in your UEFI defined to fully support what's necessary there as well. Well, this is actually the session policy for the app enforced restrictions. And the putting the policy in place is not enough because you have to modify your SharePoint environment as well. So we can do that in multiple ways. We can do that on a global level, saying that, for example, you don't give access to SharePoint and you cannot download or print files. You can do it on a per SharePoint site basis by using PowerShell. Or you can do it by implementing so-called sensitivity labels, where nowadays you can actually define what can be done on the container level. I have all kinds of information on that on my blog as well. And you can actually read the options you have there. If you would ask me what would be the long-term solution, I would go for the sensitivity labels. So start implementing them. You can do it for sensitivity labels only. And use that to actually determine what the sensitivity is within the SharePoint or Teams environment. And therefore, you can actually either have the app enforced restrictions enforced or not. These are important as well. And these have to do with the re-authentication settings, which I mentioned as well. In my policy, I actually set a sign-in frequency for all users on non-compliant devices, so each device which you don't manage, where users, for example, who have Outlook web access opened, need to sign in for at least once per day. And therefore, we actually make sure that the user needs to supply his or her credentials at least once per day, and not that if the user walks away and somebody else sits behind the screen, that they can access the environment. And another thing that we can do is actually make sure that browser persistence is disabled, which means that if the user closes the browser session, that actually the session cookie is being removed as well. So if another user would open the same browser session again, that they need to re-authenticate. It would be really harsh, for example, if the user is behind a public kiosk device, closes the browser, somebody else opens the browser, goes to portal.office.com, and they are actually logged in immediately for that user session. So these two conditional access policies are quite important if you ask me. If you want it to be more strict, you can even set the sign-in frequency to 1 hour, 2 hours, 4 hours, whatever you want. But I think that personally that 1 day is a good starting point. So based actually on the flowchart giving describing the functionality and all the conditional access policies, I actually mapped my conditional access policies to the functional flowchart. And you can actually see that a lot of them are actually situated at the start, which have to do with the identity of the users. And a lot of them are actually situated around the data in this case. So, but actually by creating this drawing, and I was busy with Visio again, I hope to make clear what the translation is between what we functionally want to accomplish and what the technical implementation of the conditional access policies actually do. So, some tips for the implementation that actually has to do with if you have Azure AD Premium P2, please use the access review functionality. make sure that you know what to do if, for example, MFA has an outage. We haven't seen it for the last year, but I have had some conditional access implementations where during the implementation, Microsoft had an Azure MFA outage, and we actually needed to be able to temporarily put some policies off. We even didn't have report-only mode at that time. But make sure that it's described what the procedures are. And it might also be that you don't want to make that exception at the moment that MFA has an outage. And MFA is only an example. It could be something else as well. Make sure that you are on top of conditional access. Follow people who are blogging about the functionality, because you might be missing out. And when you are starting to implement conditional access and all the other Microsoft functionality, Microsoft is implementing new functionality on a weekly basis. And it might be that you need to do something in order to keep functionality as well. So make sure that you know what's going on, what's new in Azure Active Directory, make sure that you see what's in the message center, etc. Some cloud applications have dependency on other cloud applications. A good example of that is Microsoft Teams. For example, if you give access to Teams but deny access on SharePoint, you have half functionality within Teams, because SharePoint is a big part of what Teams is actually providing. Test is important. To give you an example, I have all kinds of devices, Android, I have an MacBook, I have iOS devices. I'm capable of testing all scenarios which I want to support at my customers. And make sure that you actually forward your Azure AD sign-in and audit logging to a log analytics workspace, and that you have alerts in place to either alert you when new conditional access policies are created, or if existing conditional access policies are modified. As I said, conditional access policies shouldn't be modified. You create a new version of the policy with a new version number and implement that. So that should never happen when looking at my way of working. There are some situations where Microsoft automatically creates conditional access policies for you. One example is for if you enable the restricted access in SharePoint. If you enable that setting, Microsoft will create two conditional access policies for you, which are enabled and scoped to all users. And that can give some strange results, I can tell you. So if you enable that option, please disable those two conditional access policies. And it might be handy that, for example, if the SharePoint administrator does that on accident, what does this option do? You know what happens, that you are notified because of that. How can we troubleshoot conditional access? We have some options available there, and let me see if I can show you. Yeah, let me go to my other tenant. This is the tenant of the company I work for, Insight24. We have forwarding to log analytics available. And as you can see, we have the workbooks available there as well. So for example, I already did my homework, and I hope that we see an empty workbook here, because we have no sign-ins using legacy authentication. If the demo gods are with me, come on. Of course not. All we'll do in the meantime is open a new. Let's see if we have some results later on. So if we go to the sign-in logging, and we might also go to the security tab. First of all, let me show you the conditional access policy which I implemented within my tenant. So these are all the policies I have enabled within our tenant. As you can see, they have a follow-up number. They are nicely versioned. I made a mistake myself. I created a test policy for one of our test users, very common, which is turned on, which doesn't comply to that. But yeah, please excuse me for that. This is a half a production, half a test environment. Looking at the sign-in logging, we see all kinds of sign-ins. Let me see, we have a colleague here of mine, Mike, and what you can see, Mike is logged in using our password management tooling Keeper, and you can see which conditional access policies were applicable for that sign-in. You can see that there were three actually requiring multi-factor authentication. And what you can see here is, for example, that if you click on one of the conditional access policies, you will actually get an overview of that specific policy, giving you all the details and what the actual outcome was. In this case, the access to the application was granted. So if this goes wrong, you might actually see, for example, that the device state was non-compliant, giving blocking access might be an option. So we can actually see that from the sign-in logging. When going back, well, the workbook actually loaded. You can also see that we have no results because we don't have any legacy sign-ins anymore within our tenant. We have the same workbooks available for conditional access. For example, sign-ins by using conditional access. I did click on sign-ins conditional access. That one is deprecated, as you can see. But you can see that we have a lot of sign-ins using conditional access. And you can actually make a filter on which one were failed, for example. If it's working, maybe go back, see whether we have another one. So it gives us a lot of information in an easy to digest form, and maybe something which you can share with management as well, because they like graphics. Etc. The other thing that we have is we can use the what if tooling, and the what if tooling can be compared to the resultant set of policy, which you might know from when working with group policies, but it doesn't really work well, because there are many scenarios where actually the what if tooling doesn't give you enough information. It can help you to determine whether you have set up your conditional access policies correctly, though. So you actually provide the username, you provide which cloud application is being used, you can actually give the IP address, etc., and it will tell you whether or not access is granted for that specific scenario. I personally hardly use this functionality, but it's one of the functionality provided by Microsoft. So the sign-in logging is your main tooling to troubleshoot conditional access. Keep in mind that sign-in logging, and especially the last days, is not real time. So there's a lag, which can be a couple of minutes before you actually see the sign-in logging within Azure AD compared to what the user is doing. And if you are testing, make sure that you actually give or ask the user having issues to write down the exact time of when the logging has taken place. That will really help you to go to the point directly and have the view from there. So, well, there are some further resources, Stack Overflow. Make sure that you, if you really want to know what's going on with conditional access, follow user voice. Because user voice A is being used by the product team to determine what kind of functionality they want to implement next. But user voice also gives you a sentiment on what people want to accomplish with conditional access, and actually which walls they hit and they want a solution for. And if you know what walls other people hit, you don't have to hit them yourselves. So that can, for me, that actually provides a lot of valuable information. And hence, I sometimes even write blog articles based on requests I see from people on user voice as well. So that brings me almost to the end of my presentation. And with this, I want to announce a new version of my conditional access white paper. This is the third version which I actually released. The last one was from May last year, so it's almost a year ago. And that one contained 30 pages with everything I knew and know about conditional access. And I actually modified that. And it's now 77 pages, so it actually grew quite a bit. It's in PDF form. I haven't figured out yet to create an EPUB file for it, but it's available free for download. So please go to my blog, and there you will find a link where you can download it for my GitHub page. Please let me know what you think, and if you have any questions, there's a lot of information there on how to reach me as well. That actually concludes my presentation. All the references are in there. We will share the presentation for you to download, so you can have a look more in depth on all the references I made within the article. And with that, I want to thank you for your time. I don't know if there are any questions. If so, you can ask them in the chat or unmute yourself and just ask.
Haven't seen any questions, but
no. So in that case, if there are no questions, please reach out to me if you have any follow-up questions. I think I'm quite active on social media, so you probably know how to reach me. If you read the paper and you see things which you don't understand, reach out to me as well. And I will publish a new version probably in the last half of this year with all the information. So thanks for joining. 1 hour and 15 minutes. I think I did quite well. So thanks for joining again.
Yeah, thank you, Kenneth. And for the people who joined later or had something like this is an overload of information, we will publish the recording also on our YouTube channel. With that, thanks for joining. Next week, we have our own dynamic duo, Franz and Ronnie, with the Ask Me Anything Live with Samantha. And thanks again to our sponsors who make this possible. Thank you for joining and see you next time. Bye.